insignificant. Some people want to succeed in buying a house, and some may want to succeed in buying cars and education and raising family, but it doesn't matter to the scale or the magnitude of the success. People just like to succeed in life, and they want to be great at it. There's nothing wrong with wanting to be great at something. God created us that way. In fact, Jesus supported greatness. The Bible says in Mark chapter 10, verse 43, that Jesus specifically said, if you desire to be great, the first thing you ought to do is become a servant.
Amen.
And then in John chapter 14, verse 12, he said, greater works you would do because he goes to the Father.
Yeah.
This desire of success or to succeed comes from the seeds of our purpose in life. Stay with me. Unfortunately, many people will die without knowing their purpose in God's plan. Henry David Thoreau once said, most men lead lives of quiet desperation and die with the song still in them. What song's crying to come out of you? What business is thriving to come out of you? What bit of education is trying to come out of you? I discovered, in fact, one of my mentors once said, the richest place in all the world is not Qatar, it's not Dubai, and it's not Abu Dhabi, it's not even the United States of America, but it is the cemetery. The cemetery. The cemetery is filled with buried treasures. Books never written. Songs never sung.
Yes.
Music never played. Yes. Businesses never opened. Visions never fulfilled. And plans never executed. Somebody say why.
Why?
Because there are three reasons. The first one is many human beings have an identity crisis.
Mm-hmm.
The second one is they fail to reach their highest potential. The third thing is they spend most of their lives seeking after their purpose. Wondering, who am I? Where am I going? And what did God create me to be? So today's message is entitled, Celebrating Our Purpose and God's Plan. So the first thing I want to talk about is human identity. Somebody say, my identity.
My identity.
Yes, yes. Many of us spend more time trying to be like somebody else instead of who God intended us to be. I didn't think I was coming to a church, so I'm going to just lay it on you today. There are times when we literally assume that we are less acceptable and less desirable if we show up as our own selves.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Who am I talking to? Look, I understand this. The fashion industry is in the business of selling consumers the maker's identity. And guess what? We buy them. And then we strive for their identity, following what they think is fashionable, what they think is beautiful, social, and cultural. We wear their name brands and images on our shirts and shoes and new, huh? In hopes in some way identifying ourselves with the designer's purpose. We put way too much stock in what the world thinks of us than what God says about us. I'm talking about human identity. And then the second thing I'm going to share is human potential. Somebody say, my potential.
My potential.
Then somebody else says, she's talking to me right now.
God is talking to me.
Many people journey in life without utilizing their even as believers of Jesus Christ, he gives us the grace to do all that he's called us to do, yet we still don't use our fullest potential in life. Most human beings only use 10% of their brain power, leaving 90% uncharged and left as human waste. If we use only 1% more than the average person, we would be considered geniuses. So we lead ourselves to believe that we are inadequate, insufficient, and incompetent, and therefore insignificant to God and in this world. Somebody say, ain't so. Also, our culture tells us what we are capable of doing. Here, listen. There are people in our lives that will base our success on our family history. It's never been done in this family. Nobody ever opened up business. What are you talking about? You want to strive for a PhD? It's never been done in our family. Look at this. It's never been done in the church. What are you trying to do? You trying to stir up something? Ain't nobody ever pulled it out. Human potential. And then there are people in our past who dictate our future based on their opinions as if their opinions matter. You know where you came from. You know you used to be a prostitute. You knew you were strung out of drugs. You knew you were properly, they will pay to ship it to themselves. They will pay to replace or repair it, and then they will pay to send it back to you. They don't do that because they like you more than her. They don't do that because they know you, Robin Bell, and Kiss. They don't even do that because, Pastor, you got favor with God. They do that for their name's sake.
Yes.
To protect their image. And then when we look at the guarantee is a formal assurance or promise that the product will do what they say it will do. Huh? Many of us don't even read the manual. So we never take the devices and products that we purchase and pay good money for to its fullest potential. We never do. I mean, I didn't even look at the manual that came with my tablet. It may have over 100 different functions, and I only use 10. I turn it on, I put my passcode in, I pull up a document, I read a document, I check my emails, I close my email, and I shut it down. Never taking it to its fullest potential. But if every time I opened up this device and it was searching for its purpose, it would never be of any use to me. The purpose is built in the product. The purpose is built in this tool, this device. Both human identity and human potential are found in human purpose. Human purpose comes from God's plan for our life. Turn to your neighbor and say this. God has an imagination because he created you. Yes, 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 yes. Let's go back to Jeremiah 29. Are you ready to start taking notes? Amen. Jeremiah 29, verse 11. The Bible says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declare the Lord." Now, I want you to underline the word plans. If you have thought or any other translation, underline it right now. In the original text, in the Hebrew, it's mecha shabbat. Somebody say mecha shabbat. And what it means is imagination, invention, thought, device, or purpose. God intentionally created each one of us based on his imagination. Somebody say plans.
Plans.
Yes, yes. Now, when we look at the definition of imagination, it means the action of forming images or concepts. God saw something in his mind, and he created you. Now, see, I know some wordsmiths are in here, so you want to see it in the Word. So turn to Genesis chapter 1. Yes, yes. Verse 26. Okay. We'll write it down. The Bible says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image."
Come on now.
"According to our likeness." God saw something in his mind and created you. God saw himself.
Right now.
And he signed it to make you.
Yes.
In his image. Do you get it?
Amen.
Verse 27. Skip down to verse 27. "So God created man in his own image, in the image of God. He created him, male and female. He created them equal."
Yes.
Not in the image of anything else but himself. manufacturer has concerning their product, the image is placed on the product after it is completed. It's the same principle with God, that everything you need were placed in you, and then God gave you his image.
Right now.
You're not lacking anything. You have everything that God has designed for you to have, then he placed his image on you.
Thank you.
Maybe this is only good to me. God created you complete, purpose included. You don't have to search for it.
That's right.
You don't have to go from church to church seeking after your purpose. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5 says this. The Lord speaking. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you.
All right now.
Come on now.
Yes.
He said, I got you. That's Hebrew for knew you. I had a relationship with you. I knew you. I knew what you looked like. I spoke to you. I saw your entire life from the beginning to the end. I knew you. And then he said, before you were born, I sanctified you. I set you aside for a purpose.
Yes.
And then he said, I ordained you. That word ordained means intended, designed, predestined you as a captain to the nation. In other words, he said, I made you a mouthpiece.
Yes.
Huh? He did that for Jeremiah. He did it for you too. He knew you now. Before he gave you his image, he finished you with purpose.
Yeah.
Also, you were tested in advance. That's why he knows how much you can bear. He knows how much you can bear because you were tested. What? You're going to run into the second time. First is his imagination and now his image.
Yes.
Huh?
All right.
You've been through this already. God's mind now in his image. No one knows the product like the manufacturer.
All right.
This is why he has included a manual of operation.
Yes.
A book of promises called the Bible.
Yes.
Stating everything it says you can do, you can do.
All right now.
Creation is stored in the creature. Your future is not ahead of you, which we've heard. Your future lies ahead of you. Your future is before you. No, your future is within you right now. I asked years ago the congregation, my congregation in Virginia, what came first? The chicken or the egg? Some said the chicken and the other one the egg. But I'm here to tell you that both came first. They came at the same time. The end came in the beginning. The future came in the present. When God created the chicken, when he created you and everything else, it had its purpose and its future already in the present. And then if you just cut open an apple, you'll see the seed on the inside, right?
Yes.
The future is already on the inside.
Yes.
Barren apple. Have you? But it was human generated. But the future is found on the inside now. The purpose, get this. Now some of you, see, I look on this side, you look like show me the word. Genesis 1. The Bible says, then God said, let the earth bring forth grass. The herb that yields what? Seed. And the fruit tree that yields fruit according to its kind. Whose seed is in your lake? Whose seed is at your mama's house? No. Whose seed is in itself on the earth, and it was so. Now, created with the, in the beginning, the end, already on the inside. The future is in the present now. Huh? Write this down. The future is a manifested purpose. The future is a manifested purpose. God places the future of everything in itself. Like the chicken and the egg have purpose, and that purpose is to serve man. What? A chicken is supposed to serve me? Yes. Chicken fried rice, chicken out of the meat, chicken on the grill, chicken leg in your hand. But yet, this, the apple was also designed to serve man. Apple sauce, apple juice, right? Apple pop. So both you and your purpose, your future have a purpose, and your purpose is to serve. Your purpose is to serve. Were you created with your future on the inside? Yes. Were you created with your purpose inside? Yes. Your purpose is to serve. Yes. Well, God, all I want to do is serve you and hate your brother. Let this mind be in you that is also in Christ Jesus, who God has not operate to be equal with God the Father,
yes,
but still hung on something. What y'all think? God is afraid. Jesus even said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for me.
Yeah.
Right? God makes a way for your purpose in your future now. Write it down. Important. It's going to change your life forever. God makes a way for your purpose in your future now. Your future is more valuable. Your future is more important. And your future is more powerful than your past.
All right.
But see, you don't know where I came from. You don't know what I've gone through. We always got that memory of what you've been through and where you've gone and all the stuff that has happened to you in your past. And that's why you can't move forward in life. And you can't fulfill your heart and your person because you have the stuff that you have gone through. But the Bible reminds us that our future is more valuable and more important and more powerful than our past. Go to Isaiah 43 or just write it down, verse 18.
All right now.
The Bible says, do not remember the former things nor consider the things of old. Stop looking back.
Yes.
Why? You can't see what's in front of you if you keep looking back. A new thing now it right, shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? Will you miss it looking back?
Right.
And then he says, look, I like this part. I will even make a road in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. The Lord showed this to me in a vision. He says, I will cause you to fly over the highest mountains, and then I will make the trees lie down so you can walk through the forest. And I will build a bridge over troubled water. So write this down, What around you is not as important as what is in you.
Say it.
You don't know where I am. All the people I live in my house, I can't get a moment to myself. Even when I go to the bathroom, somebody knocking on the door, somebody kicking out of the prayer closet, no one there. You don't know my job and all the heathens on my job and all the things, the certain things they do. You don't know the school I go to and I find it out just to get to class. You don't know what's around me, Pastor. I can only go to the Word, y'all.
All right.
Right.
1 John 4:4. Just write the scripture down. 1 John 4:4. Here's the thing. The Bible says, you are of God, little children. Somebody say identity right there. That's my identity. I am a child of God.
Yes.
And here it goes. And have overcome the potential.
Yes.
Every situation.
Yes.
Every circumstance that you have in faith. It already overcame.
Yes.
Why? Because that's your highest potential. When you know God's got this.
Yes.
When you put your trust in him. And your thank you. office, see, you will wonder how it's going to do. We always immediately think, where am I going to get the money from? We always think about that. And every vision that God puts before us, don't you think if he gave you the vision, he will also give you the
vision?
In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, we're no longer in Jeremiah 29, so you can close that area. But go to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. I know some of you that have electronics, you already did. We hear all kinds of stuff in church, electronics, and beeps, and well, look at me. But the Bible says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. Everything we need is stored up in places we cannot see until we need them. You got everything you need to start that business. You got everything you need to build the vision. You got everything you need to do it in 2017.
Yes.
If you were contemplating whether I should get married, you can do it in 2017. God gives you everything you need. If he gave you a vision, he's going to give you the provision.
Amen.
Huh?
Yes. Why?
Because God has already finished something. He's waiting for you to start.
All right, man. Yeah.
It's already done. He's just waiting for you to begin. Why? Because you're doing it the second time. Now you're just doing it in his image.
Yes.
Turn to your neighbor and say, money is no object.
Money is no object.
Not with God. Because his image is on you. is glowing if you are a believer.
Yeah.
Now, I pulled up my bootstraps. I did this, but God.
Yeah.
Amen?
Amen.
And this is why God sent Jesus, why the Father sent Jesus. In 1 John 3:8, it says, he who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil, so that you may succeed in life. The works of the devil are destroyed.
Right now.
So there's no excuse for failure. When you know that you're already won, you're already overcome the situation that you may be facing. As I close out, we all know that Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good to those who love God and call to his purpose. For those, verse 29, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to become or be conformed to the image of his Son. He sent an example, y'all, in Jesus Christ for us to pattern our lives and model our behavior after, that he might be the firstborn of many brothers and sisters. Write this one thing down, one more thing. Write it bold. You've got a circle there. Write it over. God's plan for the kingdom comes through the pastor for this house. I'll say it again. God's plan for the kingdom comes through the pastor for this house.
Yes.
Your purpose for the kingdom is to be a mouthpiece for God. You don't have to be an ordained minister. You don't even have to be a trained evangelist. All you have to do is open your mouth and say, I need you. Amen. And by the way, I have a church home that teaches the word of God. The second thing, you are a tool in his hand to serve others with love. Don't forget love. Because if you don't do it out of love, you'll be griping about what you did.
Same.
I have to pick them up again and go to church. They call everything I feel to do. Out of love, you don't repeat it, you don't tell another.
All right, now.
The third thing is to bear his image. We ought to celebrate our purpose in God's plan because it always worked out for the benefit of our future standing.
Amen.